My name is Phil Nasca. I'm the Dean of the School of Public Health, and I want to welcome you here today for what I think is going to be a very informative and enjoyable session. We are going to have two talks, one from Dr. Martin Tenniswood of our Cancer Research Center, who will talk about the biology of Ebola, and then Professor Gus Birkhead, who is also a Deputy Commissioner at the New York State Department of Health, who will talk about the public health response to the Ebola issue. And then we'll open it up for questions and answers at the end of the two prepared talks. What I would ask you to do is we have microphones on both sides. So if you would like to ask a question, we ask you to go to the microphones and ask your question, and then either Dr. Birkhead or Dr. Tenniswood will respond. Before we start the actual program, though, one of the other things we're doing this morning is a influenza immunization program. This is called a POD, point of delivery, and this was held this morning. This comes from Dr. Mary Applegate, who is our Associate Dean for Public Health Practice and the able leadership and staff of our Center for Public Health Preparedness. And as part of this, we also offered a few gifts through a drawing, so we're going to do that first. And the first winner is Brian Aho. Is Brian here? Okay, and I'd like to introduce Sachelle Myrtle, who in fact was the incident commander. We're going to have to get her some stripes up here. And ran the program this morning, and we're very delightful. It was a roaring success, due a lot to her efforts going forward. The other one goes to Asante Shiphiltz. Okay, is Asante here? Ah, okay. Okay, and we will make sure that Brian gets his gift as well. We won't auction it off again, okay. Thank you. The other announcement people asked me to make, the Center for Public Health Preparedness is planning a special training session on personal protective equipment. This will be done in collaboration with the Albany Medical Center later this month. And if you're interested in that, there'll be a sign-up sheet in the back of the room, and you can sign up if you'd like to participate in that training going forward. So with that in mind, let's start the program. And I first would like to introduce Dr. Martin Tenniswood, who will talk about the biology of Ebola. And I will tell you, Dr. Tenniswood is not only an engaging speaker, but also could be entertaining as well. So big round of applause for Dr. Tenniswood.
Okay. So first of all, I'm in the cancer center. So I want to just establish one thing, that I actually used to live in Africa, in Uganda, and in Zimbabwe. So I do have some idea of what the African environment is like. And that's probably the only reason I'm up here. This is the... this is the typical photograph of Ebola that's produced out. It's a beautifully colorized electron micrograph of what is, in fact, a very unusual-looking virus. And as of 2 days ago, the number of infected individuals in this particular outbreak, which was predominantly in West Africa, was 13,000 individuals plus. And the death toll as of this morning was 4,941 individuals. That is not a large number of people in the world view, which I want to make a point of at this point, and I'll come back to later on. So if you look at the brief history of Ebola, it was originally identified in 1976 by Peter Pio and Guido van Guren, from a patient who died, a Belgian nun who died in Yambuka in Zaire. And the thing that scared most of the virologists more than anything else was this extraordinary structure of this virus. It's very unlike most virus structures that were known at the time, which are usually very nice icosahedral structures. They're easy to look at and understand. And this actually was probably the most scary part of the entire thing from the point of view of the investigators at the time, other than the fact that they couldn't figure out how the original transmission occurred in Yambuka. And they actually went back and did a long study in Yambuka to figure it out. So I wanted, without going through too much with you, I want to point out that the very first outbreak was in Yambuka in Zaire. There have been numerous other outbreaks in the past, ranging from places like Gulu in Uganda, all the way through Kikwit in the Congo. And what I want to point out to you very simply is there are, in fact, at least four wild-type strains of Ebola. It's not a single virus, the strains to the virus. There's also two other strains that are well-characterized that turn out to be Ebola-like viruses. One of them is called the Reston virus, which is was an outbreak in Virginia in 1989. It's the subject of the hot zone. And the other one is the Marburg virus, which was actually an outbreak that occurred in 1967. Both of these occurred because the two institutions that where these occurred brought animals in from the wild. The Reston virus is actually a strain of monkey that came from the Philippines. So that's the other point to make, is that the Ebola virus is not restricted just to the African continent. It has also got places in the wild in other parts of the world where it hasn't actually emerged yet as a real issue. So there's at least six different kinds of Ebola virus. And the current outbreak is in West Africa, and it turns out, as I'll show in a few seconds, to be related to the Zaire virus more than anything else. The other thing that's important to point out is that the outbreak in Liberia, relative to, for example, Gulu or Yambuka, that's a distance that's equivalent of between here and the Mexican border. These are not close. This is an enormous continent, and these are not closely related. There's six or seven countries in between here, okay? So it's an important point just from the point of view of the geography. The second thing I want to make a note of is that the virus actually exists in the wild in a zoonotic reservoir. Chimpanzees are actually easily infected, and they are, in fact, the probable source of the virus that landed up in Marburg. But gorillas are also infected. Deer, shrews, and fruit bats. These guys are getting all the blame at the moment. But it's quite clear that slaughtering any animal that's infected, it's actually in the preparation of the contaminated bushmeat that accounts for transmission. If you have a small cut on your hand and you're dealing with and butchering one of these animals, for example, you're likely to get contaminated. So this is probably the source. It's probably not eating cooked meat, but actually the transmission during the butchering process. So a little bit of real biology for a second. This is what the virus looks like. It's a member of the filovirus family. It's actually just a filament. It's a straight line if you stretch it out. And in fact, the Ebola genome is actually an RNA genome, and it has its own polymerase and a bunch of other proteins. I'm going to mention these later on in the talk. But I want you to understand that if it's an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, one of the things I'm going to show you is that by intrinsically has a very high error rate in reproduction when it replicates. And the other two proteins I'm going to talk about are GP and GPS, the glycoproteins. There's two of them. They're encoded in the middle here, and even if I can't spell, they're both responsible for the entry of the virus into the cell. And that becomes another important point as we go through this. So how does the Ebola virus actually produce the symptoms that it does? First of all, it infects monocytes, which are part of the immune system in the human blood system, and the white blood cells. The virus gets into the infected monocytes, and then what it does is it produces what's referred to as a cytokine storm. It produces TNF-alpha, IL-6, and IL-8. Those, in fact, affect the cells that line the blood vessels. And what it does in that situation, what they do in that situation, is they cause the cells to uncouple from the basement membrane, and it makes the blood vessels leaky. And this is what produces the syndrome that you see of having all of the leakiness and all of the bleeding out of the different orifices because of this leakiness that occurs. The other thing it does is it causes these cells to die that are infected, and they land up putting the virus load back into the bloodstream, which can then leak out. And in fact, it lands up going into the intestine, and then one of the latest stages of this disease is massive diarrhea. And so the infected individual shed the virus into both the bloodstream and the intestines. The other thing that actually causes death more often than not is the fact that you land up losing all of the blood, the liquid, the fluid out of the blood, and you land up with what's called hypovolemic shock. And that's actually the predominant reason for the death. One of the things we know is if you have an individual that's affected, they're going to lose 10 to 20 liters of fluid. And you can replace that fluid by continual infusion of fluids. And that's one of the major things that you do to stop the disease from progressing and killing at the time. So I mentioned to you that the Ebola virus is actually replicated through use of its own RNA polymerase. And essentially what happens is the Ebola virus is continually mutating, which is an issue. This is work that was published literally a couple of months ago by the Broad Institute in Boston. They got all the samples from the initial outbreak in Africa and analyzed them using deep sequencing technologies. And it's really a tour de force, but it's incredibly powerful technologies. And one of the things they've shown is that the way the virus presents itself to the host, the infected individual, is through the glycoproteins. And one of the things you can see is the glycoproteins don't change very much. You get lots of mutations in the nuclear proteins, in some of the other proteins that are involved in the RNA transcription, and in the structure of the matrix. And you even get changes in the polymerase itself. But the glycoprotein, which essentially is the outward face of the virus, doesn't seem to mutate very frequently. That's actually a very good thing, because it means that if you have a virus that you've identified and you're developing a system to treat that virus, it will probably work from strain to strain. It's not going to be one of the things like the flu where you have to change the virus or the vaccination system every year. The other thing that this study actually did was to look at the fact that the Ebola patients, that particularly in Guinea, which is where most of the study was done, are actually virtually all of them have other comorbidities. They have comorbidities of poverty, essentially, but they also have high rates of malaria, HIV, and Lassa fever. So when we think about the populations in Africa, they already have numerous issues with their health anyway, which is probably why the death rate is very high, and why when you have individuals who are isolated in Europe or in the States, the death rate seems to be much lower. It's because of their standard of health to start with. The other thing I want to make a point about is the fears that have gone through the lay literature, and that is that Ebola is a highly infectious disease. In fact, it's not. It's a very non-infectious disease. You really do have to be exposed and contact multiple copies of the virus to have a chance of getting the disease. And the thing is that this is actually something called the R-naught. It's a basic reproduction number. And what it does is it measures how many people a particular infectious disease will infect if they are not otherwise protected. And to give you an example, measles is highly infectious. You know, mumps is highly infectious. SARS and HIV less so. And Ebola is very far down on the infectious scale. So good care and attention to barrier facilities will in fact result in being able to contain the virus. It's not infectious. It is contagious and not infectious. Slight difference. So when the R0 of the infection is less than one, the infection will actually die out because less than one person is going to get infected for every person who has the disease. And the lower it is, it'll spread through the population. If it's greater than one, the chances that Ebola is going to spread through the population if you put into place reasonable containment procedures is very, very limited. Okay. So what are the obstacles to actually treating Ebola in country, or what I refer to, in fact, in West Africa? One of the major sites for the infection is ironically called West Point. Okay. It's in Monrovia. It's actually a peninsula of land. This river separates West Point from most of Monrovia. But you can see there's a couple of things that show up here very quickly. It's a real shanty town. There is no form of sewage treatment. There is no running water, and there's very little electricity. And basically, there's no kind of garbage containment. So this is actually an unregulated shanty town. It's not uncommon in African cities. And Liberia, as you may know, has been racked by civil war for 25 years before Sirleaf Johnson took over. And there's no infrastructure in the country. That actually spreads over to Sierra Leone. The major center in Sierra Leone is Kanema Government Hospital. And Kanema actually is interesting because it has no electricity that's constant. The electrical supply is very limited. It's very, very difficult to maintain an electrical supply. The lab building, which is here, actually has electron, what are those things called? Whatever. The other thing that's important to notice is the main hospital in Monrovia is called JFK Hospital, John F. Kennedy Hospital. It actually has no running water. It has very limited supplies. This is actually the isolation ward. It's not an isolation ward per se. One of the things that you can see here is everybody has their own blankets. The patients have to have their family come to feed them. There's no hospital supplies. That means that there's absolutely no way of isolating these patients from the general population. And that's one of the other problems. I'm also going to point out to you, because this becomes important when we talk about protection, the average daytime temperature in Liberia most of the year is 30 degrees centigrade, 90 degrees Fahrenheit. And it's 100% humidity. Today, there's expected to be about 4 hours of thunderstorms during the day. So there's no isolation wards, it's extremely hot, it's very humid, it's very difficult to actually regulate. So one of the things that's happened in the course of this infection is that Médecins Sans Frontières, which happens to be my favorite charity of all time, so I'll plug them, as of October 20th, they were actually operating 6 case management centers throughout this infected region. Guékédéko Do is actually in Guinea. It's got 85 patients. This is the site of the original patient zero, if you like. There are 46 patients in the facility right now and 41 confirmed cases. Monrovia has a 250-bed suite, 140 patients, and 130 confirmed cases. That's of today. The interesting thing is, 2 weeks ago, these facilities were full. And if you go through and look at the other sites, they all have far fewer full beds than they had 2 weeks ago. And it's because MSF and others, are getting that infection and the outbreak under control. If you look at this, MSF actually runs 600 isolation beds. The total number of isolation beds in the entire area is just under 1,000. So they're operating most of the beds in the area. And they've had 4,900 patients admitted, 3,200 confirmed cases, and of those, just over 1,000 have walked out alive. Okay. So what they do, what MSF does, is they can't use the local infrastructure. So what they do is they take in an entire case management system. I'm not going to go through it all with you, but this is essentially, it has two fences, a double fence around it. You're actually triaged into this area. You go into the suspect case, the high medium probability case, and the Frank Ebola cases, and you move through there depending on your symptoms and signs and symptoms. And if you land up in this ward, you come out in one of two ways. You either go out through the morgue or you walk out through the exit. Okay. The important thing about this is it's absolutely set up to be fully contained and it's self-contained. This is the personal protection gear that is recommended and required of anybody working with Ebola, with MSF. And this is actually the medium level ward that they're showing here. The thing is that the point I want to make to you is that MSF, because it's on the ground and because it's dealing with Ebola patients and has been for 15 years now, for all of the last outbreak since 2000, they have developed the most stringent barrier protocols for triage and treatment. And they're far better because they're on the ground and facing it every day than anybody else in the country that's going to get a sporadic case of this, okay, of Ebola turning up. So there are other infectious procedures. So in Gulu Municipal Hospital in Uganda, this is just down the road from where I was born, so I like to show this. But Ebola has actually reared its ugly head numerous times in Uganda. And in fact, up until this outbreak, Uganda had the highest death rates. And they have developed a really good treatment protocol. This is their isolation ward. It's not as isolated as you might expect, but everybody wears good protective clothing, and they actually behave sensibly. They have white clothing on the bed, and they change it, and they wash it. It's very different. But the other thing they've done, which is really critical to the outbreak, nobody's heard about it, but there's an outbreak of Marburg virus in Uganda right now. But it's fully contained, and they've actually isolated the patients. And they have, what's most important to this, they have contact tracking systems that identifies and isolates the patients who have had people who have had contact with those patients. So it's a critically important part of this whole process, not just the treatment, but identifying the people that have, in fact, had contact. What's remarkable about that is that in Uganda, it's all done by cell phones. Because they may not have many other things, but everybody in Uganda and most of East Africa has cell phones, so they do it through a cell phone-based system. Okay, the Charité Hospital in Berlin is probably the ultimate place if you want to go see how the security is. They have one-piece biohazard suits with a full-on face mask and everything else. The reason Charité's got that system set up is because of the Marburg outbreaks, which occurred in Marburg in Germany. And they killed a number of people in the 1960s. They've been ready for another outbreak of an infectious disease like this since then. And that what they do is you go into the isolation ward here, dressed like this, and when you emerge from the isolation ward, the door's here, you actually get sprayed with a solution that's got soap in it, and it's also got 2% chlorine, okay? So that's how you kill and ensure that you don't transmit the disease or pick up the disease when you leave. We don't have that system set up except at several hospitals associated with the CDC, essentially. So there are two tests for the Ebola virus that have been currently in use. I'm mentioning those very quickly. They're actually based on polymerase chain reaction. And what it does is it actually identifies what's the NP protein that's present in the NP RNA that's present in the serum of infected individuals. It's been in use since 2000. It was developed for the outbreak in Uganda. And it was first used to identify the patients in Gulu. It's been used continually. So when you hear that somebody has been tested negative for the virus, this is the test that they're basing it on. They also have another test called an ELISA test, which actually measures the level of the proteins in the blood. The thing is that the PCR test identifies infected individuals 24 to 48 hours earlier than the ELISA test. And that's actually just at the time that patients show any signs of infection, you can detect the virus in their blood. So if you have suspicions, it's best to use the PCR test. That allows you to isolate a patient very quickly, very early on. It helps their treatment, and it limits the exposure to individuals who might be exposed if the patient is showing signs of infection. Very quickly, too, there are several treatments for the Ebola virus. The one that everybody's talking about is called ZMAP, and it's going to be put into clinical trials in patients in Africa very shortly. The problem with this system is it's actually a very clever way of doing this. They've identified three antibodies from mice that work to kill Ebola virus. But they haven't stopped there. They've humanized the antibodies, which is an interesting process. And then they've taken those antibodies and infected plants with them, specifically tobacco. So you can grow the tobacco plants up and isolate the proteins from that. But that's never been done before. We've never taken a plant-derived or tobacco-derived protein product and put it into humans. So the reservations that everybody has about ZMAP rests entirely with the fact that it's a very new technology. It's a marvelous technology because if it proves to work, all you have to do is harvest tobacco that's been transfected with these genes, and you have a never-ending supply of the ZMAP. It would be awesome. We'd finally put tobacco to good use. So the argument that's being made now, the World Health Organization has said, in because of the seriousness of the outbreak, and provided that some conditions are met, they're happy to do this. The problem is that this particular product is still only being grown in greenhouses, not out in open fields, so we won't have enough supply to actually treat any large number of patients until probably March or April. And by that time, I predict the whole Ebola scare will have diminished a fair bit. One of the things I want to make a note of, it's not a vaccine. It only lasts in the circulation for about 3 weeks. So it's not something that can be used as a vaccination technology. There's another technology that's been produced by the Canadian National Microbiology Labs in Winnipeg. It's called VSV Ebola V. Okay, and it basically, it's very similar. It's a three cloned antibodies. It's been made in human cells, which makes it a little bit easier to get past all the FDA regulations. Right now, they're actually waiving the FDA regulations, so they're going to market. The problem is, or going to trial, they've only got 1,500 vials of the vaccine. And they need 1,000 of those. They're giving away 1,000 right now, but they need some for a phase one clinical trial. And again, you've got a limited number and availability. The final thing I want to point out to you is actually a company called Biocris Pharmaceuticals that's been making antiviral reagents for many years. And they actually have an antiviral structure here. It's a antiretroviral, and it's actually something that will be incorporated into the growing strand of the RNA by the polymerase, and this actually stops the polymerase from working. And it's very powerful. It's actually the same kind of methodologies that used for all of the HIV-based antiretroviral compounds. And in fact, this particular drug was developed for the treatment of yellow fever, which is equally problematic in Africa. So, just to finish up on the takeaway messages, first of all, there's at least 6 different strains of the virus. And the virus in West Africa is actually most closely related to Ebola Zaire, even though there's 1,500 miles between the last outbreak and this one. The thing that I haven't talked about is that this virus is actually very sensitive to dehydration, and it does not survive for more than a few hours. In fact, some reports say 15 minutes away from the host fluids. And the thing is that what you have to do is to use simple standard disinfectants like bleach and liquid soap will work very well to sterilize surfaces, whether it's personal protective gear or whether it's other surfaces in the labs or in the clinics. And the thing is that all we really need is to have incredible vigilance using essentially the techniques that have been developed by Médecins Sans Frontières to actually have that point of contact to protect healthcare workers. When they break down, as they did in Dallas, it's simply because of lack of experience. It's not because anything unusual was done. They were dressed appropriately. Taking the gowns off turns out to be a critical issue. And the other thing that's really critical from the point of view of looking at this at a population level, really the issue is contact tracking and monitoring anybody that might have been exposed to the virus. And that will work in the States. It's a question of knowing who's come from the different parts of the world and tracking who they have been in contact with in the meantime. And the other thing I'd say to you is that we can actually do this very well. The tracking for the virus is rapid, very sensitive and specific. And the reason that there's been issues with the initial patient that came in and being sent home is simply because it's such a rare event in this country that it was missed. If that had happened in West Africa or Uganda, that individual would have been kept and contained until it was established he didn't have the disease. It's not a huge issue to do that. And that's all I have to say for now.
Thank you, Dr. Tenniswood. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Gus Birkhead. He is the Deputy Commissioner at the New York State Department of Health, but also he is a full professor in the School of Public Health and has been a great friend of the school for many, many years. I won't tell you how many, but... So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Birkhead.
Thanks very much, Phil. Hi, everybody. It's great to be here this afternoon to talk about what's become my favorite and only topic in the last month or so. This has been quite an intense period of time for all of us working in public health, and through the weekends and often through the nights. It's been quite an experience. I want to start out, I've been asked to talk about the public health response to Ebola, and first to just acknowledge that there is a level of concern out there in the U.S. about this. Clearly, there's a very serious epidemic going on in Africa, which seems to be worsening, although Dr. Tenniswood mentioned some information that maybe things are getting better because the empty bed count is increasing. The cases that occurred that came into the country in Texas and in New York City, I think, really demonstrated that it can happen. It can happen, and it probably will happen. And the healthcare workers in Texas, I think, demonstrated that Ebola can be transmitted in this country. And so I think all of those steps along the way were sort of a wake-up call. If those in public health and healthcare hadn't already been awakened, those episodes awakened things. And I think out in the general population, there's a level of concern. We've set up a system where we get an email from any county health department that hears about a suspect case. And all of these are basically people who are not feeling well, may have come in contact with someone who may have traveled somewhere. So we really, people are, I think, almost overdoing the level of concern at some level when you talk about out in our communities. So people are concerned, but I think the reality is that in this country, we're at very, very low risk of encountering Ebola, particularly in our communities. As Dr. Tenniswood said, Ebola is not easily spread. It's not spread through the air or food or water or casual contact. The case in Texas, I think, is a good case in point. That person lived in a small apartment for 4 to 5 days, sick with Ebola, with a number of other people in the household, including small children, and no one became ill in that group living with this individual in the same house. He went to the emergency room on the first occasion and waited to be cared for, interacted with a number of healthcare workers, and again, no one became ill among that group. So not easily transmissible. Where transmission did occur was when the patient was quite ill, and this particular strain of Ebola seems to cause a serious problem with diarrhea. A lot of fluid loss, fluid imbalance, which can lead to respiratory failure. The patient in Texas received dialysis. They were on a ventilator. There were, as I understand it, up to 12 liters of diarrhea a day. So an environment where Ebola virus was very present, and so that even the type of protective equipment that was used there was overwhelmed. At least two healthcare workers became ill. So it really points out that's the setting where there's a risk in a hospital where you have this environment with Ebola virus potentially coming from many sources, and really a need to have meticulous care taken to the protective equipment. The other thing to just comment about the United States, and Dr. Tenniswood said this, is that conditions here are very different. Not only in Africa do you have crowding, you have poor sanitation, but you don't have hospitals. People care for the sick family members at home, and that's where I think a lot of the transmission is going on in the communities there, is people caring for family members with direct contact. And I think one of the strategies that may be employed more now is to provide some basic barrier precautions, gloves and other things, to family members who are going to care for family at home if the hospitals are basically overwhelmed. So it's a dual problem in Africa. There certainly is transmission that occurs in the hospital settings, and you saw the picture of the wards with many, many patients lined up with Ebola in one room. Here, of course, we are a single patient. We're dealing with in a very secure and closed environment. So things are very different here than they are in Africa, and I think the chances that we would see anything here that's happening like there is happening in Africa, I think is very, very unlikely. So to talk a little bit about our setting now in the United States and what we can do, over the years that I've been working in public health, we've actually prepared our healthcare system to deal with any number of infectious diseases, beginning with SARS over a decade ago, pandemic H1N1 flu in 2009, the regular reoccurrence or concern about avian flu, Just the regular flu season itself, when we have a severe flu season, we really need to pay attention. And that can kill hundreds or even thousands of people in the United States each year. So our system is geared for this. Earlier this spring, we sent out messages about Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, which is a SARS-like agent that could cause problems, particularly in hospitals, if people aren't paying attention and taking precautions. So this Ebola outbreak is not new. It's something that we've been working with the healthcare system in the state and in the U.S. for a number of years. So just to get to, there's sort of three things that we're doing in public health that are core to our public health response right now. The first public health measure is the rapid recognition, isolation, and diagnosis of suspected cases. And so what we're doing, for example, is now following all travelers coming back into the United States from the three African countries for 21 days, and that information is coming to us from the federal government, and our county health departments and city health department in New York City are following every traveler who returns from those settings, whether or not they say they have any contact with Ebola patients, and with daily temperature checks, daily check-ins, a plan should they become ill as to where to go. So the whole thrust of that is to identify, rapidly recognize someone who's becoming ill with Ebola and getting them isolated, getting them into a medical setting where they can be cared for, but preventing any further transmission from occurring. The second thing that we're doing is, and this is really key, is to prevent healthcare workers from getting infected by a patient with Ebola once they are recognized and in the hospital. And so there's been a lot of effort going on, and I'll say a little more about getting hospitals settings trained up on how to recognize a patient, ask the right travel questions when people come in, get them isolated. But then when you have an Ebola patient, to really have a team trained to care for them, and we've actually designated hospitals in New York to be the preferred location where we would care for an Ebola patient. So preventing healthcare workers from getting infected, and as I mentioned, the two cases of transmission that have occurred in the U.S. are in healthcare settings to healthcare workers. So that's clearly where we need to focus a lot of attention. And then the third public health strategy, once we have a case, is to identify all the contacts of that case and follow those individuals for 21 days as well. In Texas, I think we saw this, that they identified initially a few, then 100, then back down. So a focus on the people who've had any kind of contact with a case as they were getting ill. And remember that Ebola is not transmitted until you have symptoms. With the case in New York City, similarly, identifying contacts, a number of people asked to stay at home and check their temperatures and check in with public health every day. So dealing with the contact tracing is the sort of the third leg of the stool, public health stool, to keep people, to try and prevent Ebola. And the healthcare workers themselves who care for Ebola patients obviously are taking their temperatures and checking daily with either the hospital or public health, all in an effort to be sure that if there should occur another case, that case can be quickly isolated and not transmit to anyone else. So those are the strategies that we're following in New York. And let me just highlight some of the things that we've done. Even back in August, when this was becoming a concern, we've sent out guidance to all the healthcare settings, hospitals, clinics, physicians, and others. We did some webinars back then. At that point, it seemed like, yeah, we're educating people, but this is not really real yet. The Texas case made it real. After that episode in Texas, we first asked each hospital to do a drill in their emergency department to have a mock patient walk in who was unknown to the ED staff and say, I have a fever, I'm throwing up, I have diarrhea at home, and see if the question got asked, have you traveled recently? And that's not a question that we've just started to promote, with Ebola. As I mentioned back in the spring, we suggested that question be asked around Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, which is travel to another part of the world, the Middle East. And then if you ask the question to then say what happened next, and the response if a patient says yes, I have fever and diarrhea and I've been in Liberia, is to move that patient immediately into an isolation room close the door, gown up some staff to go in and finish the evaluation. So that exercise was actually sort of eye-opening, I think, to a lot of hospitals. They realized that they might have some gaps in that first line of defense, and so went to work on it. And then shortly thereafter, we issued a commissioner's order out of the health department, something that I've seen used only very rarely in my time, but basically ordering hospitals and clinics to develop a written protocol based on the CDC guidelines to codify that guidance and to assure that staff were trained on a regular basis, that they did drills, that they had PPE, personal protective equipment, available, that they dealt with issues or had a plan for how you would deal with waste and laboratory testing and other things. And around that time, we also designated hospitals to be the preferred site of care for Ebola. These are the typical tertiary care medical centers around the state where critically ill patients go to anyway, and so we've been working with them to get them prepared. I think the case that occurred in New York was another wake-up call, and in that this was an individual who had come back from Africa, and actually, in retrospect, it was handled very well. He called in to say he was ill. He was transported safely. He was moved into the hospital safely. We hope there will be no other cases related to him. So in that sense, it went very well. So following that, we've actually codified that process in a commissioner's order as well, so that we're checking people coming in through Kennedy Airport primarily, and healthcare workers who come through that route, we will ask to stay at home for the 21-day period while public health checks up on them. So a lot of these things are going into place. So those are really the three legs of the public health response that we've been dealing with. As I say, it's been a pretty intense period of time. The state and local health departments have been dealing with a lot of this, and it's actually a good time for us to demonstrate the value of public health in preventing this from going further. So I think just one final thing to mention, flu season is coming. I'm glad to see that you had a pod today. I'm going back and getting my flu shot after this is over this afternoon at our pod at the health department. Many more people die of flu and will die of flu this year than will die of Ebola in the United States. And so we need to focus on those things where we can do something. It will also help uncrowd our emergency departments and reduce the number of people coming in with fever who we then have to be concerned about. Is this Ebola? No, it's probably flu, which is equally transmissible, and you do need to protect the healthcare workers against flu as well. But it's something to think about, to try and put it into perspective. So I'll just end by saying there's a lot of information on our website. We have a lot of Q's and A's. There's also a 24/7 800 number to call, 800-861-2280. Certainly, if you want more information, those are two good places to start. So I think we'll stop there, and we'll see if there are questions.
Thank you, Dr. Birkhead. I just want to mention that 30 years ago, David Axelrod, who was the commissioner of the New York State Department of Health, and Vince O'Leary, who was the president of the university, came together to form the School of Public Health as a new model, and a tight collaboration between the New York State Department of Health and a Research One university. And I think today's program is an excellent example of how well that model has been working over the past 30 years. So we'll open the floor for questions. We have microphones on both sides. And please step up, and I'll ask Dr. Tenniswood to come up and see. I think the lawnmower left. Okay, good.
That's what it is.
Hi, Dr. Birkhead. I'm wondering who is doing this door-to-door, if you will, check of the people who are suspected to have Ebola in terms of numbers, where they come from, and also what is this costing the state and who's paying for it?
So this is being done by your local health departments in the communities around the state. We have most of the returning travelers since October 11th, when we've been doing this, have gone into New York City. So the city health department is doing that there. But we do have folks around in other parts of the state as well. And it's the local health departments who are generally making an initial contact, but doing a lot of phone contact thereafter to just check on people, to have a plan. What if you become ill? Call us. We'll help get you transported in. So that's what we've been focusing on, is getting that up and going.
And what's the cost incurred in all this, and who pays for it?
Well, this is coming out. This is the public health budget in the state, both the state and the local health departments. I haven't had time to focus on the number. So everybody's basically working full out at the state and local level on
and
this.
And one follow to it: did you need to do updated training for those who are working with the suspected cases of Ebola? You know, for the people, your city and county health department.
Yeah, we've done a series of phone calls with various sectors, with the local health departments around the protocols for the contact tracing, with the hospitals in general about the safe reception and diagnosis and isolation of a case, and with the designated centers around the care issues. So there's an intensive effort. We have multiple calls a week with all the sectors.
Okay, I think we'll go over to the left here.
So I was interested, Doctor, in what you said about the PCR blood test showing being able to detect Ebola 24 to 48 hours before symptoms. I walked in just a few minutes late, and I'm wondering if you spoke to the issue of relative contagiousness of someone who's not yet showing symptoms, and what the protocol is for local health departments for secondary contacts who may not be showing symptoms, but for whom a blood test may detect it. So can you talk about whether someone who is not yet showing symptoms is contagious, and how that works?
So the clinical data says, and I think it's good data, says that if you're not showing signs and symptoms of the disease, you're not infectious. The other thing that's very clear is the viral load increases with the length of time after infection. So if you are infected and for the first couple of days, you're definitely shedding virus, but at very low levels, and then it goes up very dramatically after that. So PCR testing, there's two issues with the basis of PCR testing. You could use that for everybody that walks into the clinic complaining of a fever, and that would very quickly waste an awful lot of money because it wouldn't be a productive use of the funds. But it's very important for people that have gone through and you've answered the appropriate questions. They've been traveling to West Africa. They have a friend who's come from West Africa, that have the appropriate questions and showing the appropriate symptoms, to immediately do a PCR test. That PCR test takes about 4 hours. So turnaround time in the clinic is less than 24 hours to have a positive or a negative test. If you have somebody that is seriously at risk of having the disease, you have to repeat the test a couple of times to establish that it's not still, that it doesn't become positive. And that's the test that they use at the end to make sure that people are not showing any signs of viral contamination before they're told that they're virus-free.
I guess the second part of my question
was for Dr.
Birkhead.
Could I just clarify something in your question? The PCR test is not reliably positive until the third day of symptoms.
Yes.
What Dr. Tenniswood was saying is that the PCR test is positive before the ELISA test is positive by a couple of days.
Yes.
But at the first onset of symptoms, the PCR is likely to be negative. Therefore, if you're going to be testing people, you can't rule it out with a negative test early. You need to wait at least till 3 days of symptoms to rule out.
Can I ask one follow-up question, which was really for Dr. Birkhead? And it's about the protocol, the state or local health department protocol for contacts. So not for folks who've gone to West Africa or had direct contact with patients, but for contacts of people who have. If they're asymptomatic, what is the recommendation from the health department for what to do with those folks?
There's no restriction on people here who are contacts of people who traveled. They're not at risk. They're a second level out from risk. So there's no restriction at all for that type of person.
Thank you.
Okay. My question is for Dr. Birkhead and Tenniswood as well. I would like to know, I know that the World Health Organization is working closely with a lot of countries to, I guess, monitor the pandemic. Are there any global protocols put in place as of now that kind of agree, where all countries come to a general consensus so that when we are screening or I guess, looking at travelers who've come from West Africa, that we are not overlooking maybe travelers who have come from other countries who have been exposed? And then also, do you think that there's a risk that has probably not been estimated from people who may have symptoms or who have traveled to these countries, but out of fear of quarantine, may not, you know, honestly relate that to health officials?
So just on your second question, I think in the 7 or 8 months that this Ebola outbreak is going on, there have been a total of 2 cases coming into the United States. If someone lied on their form and then came in and developed Ebola, we would know it because they would come to medical attention and they'd be diagnosed. So I don't know, you know, how honestly people are responding, but the fact is we haven't seen, you know, more than a handful of cases that we've seen. Okay. In terms of your first question about coordination, I think there is coordination, but each country probably is doing things a little bit differently, and in the U.S., each state may be doing things a little bit differently. So it's a local decision about how you know what level of risk you're prepared to accept and what you want to do to respond to that.
Okay.
Gus, could I follow up on our question? Now, despite the fact there are some local differences, you find out that the basic approach though is being followed pretty generally among all the states and across the world?
No, I think the three parts of our response, which I mentioned, those are the core of it everywhere. So those basic things are being done everywhere, sure.
Over on the left there?
Yeah, could you just describe a little better the recommended PPE? I mean, it was hard to ascertain from the picture. As far as the suit is concerned, does it need to be a sealed seam suit? And the mask, is it an N95 or would a standard hospital mask? And also the gloves, it looked like pretty heavy duty gloves. Would a standard nitrile glove or double glove nitrile
suffice? Right, so it partly depends on the setting you're talking about. In an outpatient or ED setting, when you first encounter a patient, CDC's just issued guidance for that kind of outpatient setting, and a fluid resistant gown, 2 pairs of nitrile gloves, a surgical mask and a face shield are sufficient for the initial evaluation and diagnosis of a patient that's not having a lot of bodily fluid exposure. Once you get somebody into a hospital setting, then it changes. And there are detailed guidelines. CDC does recommend two pairs or even 3 pairs of gloves. The nitrile gloves are okay, I believe. And then, you know, no exposed skin. So now, as a result of what happened in Texas, they're recommending a full head cover over either an N95 or what's called a powered pressurized air, a PAPR, essentially a pressurized air device. So they are recommending when there's a lot of fluid present in the environment, patients on a respirator, et cetera, to use respiratory protection as well. So the suits generally at that point are the suits that don't have permeable seams on them, right.
Thank you.
Yep.
You have a question on the right now?
For Dr. Birkhead, were you or anybody else in the health department consulted before the governors of New York and New Jersey announced their quarantine policy, and would you have recommended that or something different?
No, the Commissioner of Health was involved heavily with that, so that's now the policy that we're following.
Thank you. I had a question about the use of PCR assays versus the ELISA assays. So basically, if the PCR assays show positive test results before the ELISA assays, in what circumstances would you use the ELISA assay before a PCR, or do you mostly use them in conjunction?
Yeah, in the U.S., I'm not sure there is even a licensed ELISA assay. So we're using the PCR test. CDC has made the kit available to state health department labs, and the city health department lab also has the PCR kit. So we're capable of doing that. As Dr. Tenniswood said, it takes 4 to 6 hours to do that test result. FDA recently has approved an emergency use authorization for a kit that hospital labs can use that gets a result in an hour. It's not as sensitive as the PCR assay that public health labs are using, but we are working to get that available again, a negative test result early on does not rule out Ebola. So you need to take precautions based on the history and the symptoms.
You'll ask.
So if I could add to that, one of the places that you use ELISA is in countries where there's no reliable
electrical supply. Maybe it's only in the
PCR requires a stable, long-term electrical supply to actually run the equipment. The ELISA assay is not. That's the major difference. So it's used in different parts of Africa simply because it's something that's not so susceptible to temperature changes and to electrical supplies as the PCR would be. That's all.
It appears that's the technical side of the room, and this is the social side of the room. Back to the social side for a moment. The AP had a report out last week concerned about actually readiness for hospitals in the United States in the unlikely event that there is more of an outbreak of Ebola, particularly looking at supplies and inadequate amount of supplies. Local emergency departments are also complaining and reporting that they don't have enough supplies. Can you comment on this in terms of your sense as you look around the state and the health department's perspective about it?
So we've actually surveyed hospitals about this, and yes, when you're ordering, making big orders today, many people are ordering at the same time, so there's probably a holdup in the system. But I think in general, we're advising people to keep ordering and get the supplies that you need. We also have a state stockpile, which we would use in an emergency situation if there was an Ebola patient that we needed to provide ongoing care for. We could release stuff from that stockpile to be used.
I know she's got a great question, but one follow-up is that we don't have a hospital in the Albany area, in the capital region, designated in the event of an Ebola case. Why is that?
We're working with the major hospital systems in the area to come up with a plan. That I think the concern is, as has been reported, that a case might shut down some of their other functions because it is fairly intensive to care for a case. So we're looking very aggressively for a local solution to that.
Thank you. What was the scientific rationale for the 21-day decision? I mean, why not 10? Why not 30? Why not?
Very good question. I think it's based on the data from outbreaks in Africa that show the incubation period from exposure to disease. So the typical incubation period is 8 to 10 days, but apparently there have been cases with an incubation period as short as 2 days and as long as, I don't think that out to 21 days, 21 days is probably a margin of error built into that number. Mm-hmm. So I'm not familiar with the exact data, but it's based on data from patients who had a known date of exposure and how long it took them to become ill.
Okay.
Yes, hi, Dr. Birkhead. I was wondering if you could talk about the criteria that was used to choose the hospital statewide that were designated to be Ebola treatment centers.
So we, for a number of years in the preparedness world, have been working with the major tertiary hospitals who are usually academic medical centers. That's the group that we have funded in the past to do preparedness activities. They are also the major trauma centers and other centers. So in a region, those are the hospitals where critically ill patients will find themselves going. And so it made sense, I think, to focus on them as the likely suspects for where an Ebola patient would need to be cared for.
Yes. Thank you. Thanks so much. This is so informative. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the progression of the symptomatology, because I think the concern, you know, with the quarantine and non-quarantine is that the physician in New York City came and his temperature was fine one day and the next it had spiked 5 degrees. So can you just elaborate a little bit of what it looks like on a normal, I guess, progression?
Well, I'm not sure if there is an absolutely normal progression, but fever is certainly a prominent feature early on, and various descriptions describe, a high spiking fever starting from the beginning. Now, I think as we learn more with lots of cases, the fever may be lower grade to start with, but it's a pretty dramatic illness when it gets going, and it's not something where sort of you're feeling not too well one day and a little better the next and maybe a little not so much the next day. It's much more, I think, of a progressive and severe illness. So what's described as severe headache, severe muscle aches within the first day or two of symptoms, and then progressing nausea, vomiting, and then progressing with diarrhea. So it's predominantly musculoskeletal pain, headache pain, and GI symptoms, not respiratory symptoms.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, my question is for Dr. Birkhead. I actually have two questions. So the first question is, say a patient travels from West Africa, or by some means there's somebody in Albany who is positive for Ebola. Where will that patient go to? Where will be the nearest hospital that they'll be sent to, given that we don't have one in Albany? And my second question is, in light of what happened in Texas, does the state have medication ready for people who actually have Ebola in New York State to treat them so that they don't go, you know, into some of the...
So I think where a patient goes really depends on the circumstances, where they are, what's available at the time. So there's not a stock answer to that question. We would determine at the time, based on the circumstances, what was in the best interest of that patient for their care. The patient in Bellevue Hospital actually is receiving experimental therapies. We don't have a stockpile of them, but we work with the CDC to be sure that there are a number of different experimental therapies, as Dr. Tenniswood mentioned, that are made available. And many of the patients have also gotten a transfusion of serum from one of the Ebola survivors. So that's happened in the Bellevue case as well. So we would certainly work to facilitate that.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi there. Thanks. As other people have said, this has been extremely helpful and informative. I had a question. Obviously, healthcare workers are a special subset of the population at high risk of contracting Ebola. Are there other segments of the population that are at high risk either of developing Ebola or of having poor outcome compared with others? I mean, immunocompromised people, obviously, but age groups, other factors that people should be aware of?
I think probably Ebola, like other severe illnesses, would impact people at the extremes of age and people with other chronic illnesses. Obviously, this is an insult on the system, fluid shifts, other problems happening. So anyone with a chronic illness is probably has a rougher time with Ebola, and extreme age probably similarly.
Could you just give us, in a nutshell, for the general public, what are the precautions to take? If you're on the subway, if you're taking the train, if you're in a, close public, in close contact with others using public restrooms, just the basic. Thank you.
Wash your hands frequently. It'll prevent the flu.
Well, I want to thank both Dr. Tenniswood and Dr. Birkhead for a very informative set of talks. And I want to thank the audience for a number of excellent questions as well. I think that was a good Q&A session. I just want to make one more comment. Event today is really in many ways brought about by the tremendous efforts of Mr. John Justino, who is the director of our Center for Global Health, and you can thank him for putting this together. And I think the last take-home message I saw from Dr. Tenniswood's slides is poverty breeds disease, and we have to fight not only the disease itself, but the poverty that produces it. So thank you all for coming. Appreciate it.